we have a very exciting session. Our first speaker needs very little discussion for the state-of-the-art lecture on the Chronic Liver Failure Consortium and acute on chronic liver failure. Professor Arroyo is professor at the University of Barcelona Medical School. His contributions in the areas of circulatory dysfunction, renal failure, ascites, and infection in cirrhosis are probably without peer anywhere in the world. He has received multiple awards and has been probably one of the greatest contributors in this area of research and clinical care. It's a true pleasure to ask Professor Arroyo to give us this state-of-the-art lecture on chronic liver failure.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. And, you know, I will present you the main research that it is being carried out by an European consortium devoted to investigate cirrhosis. And it will deal with a new syndrome that is named acute on chronic liver failure. And this is a typical history of one case with the syndrome. It was a 52 years old man, social drinker with alcoholic cirrhosis. The patient had prior history of ascites, were being treated with diuretic to prevent reaccumulation of fluid, but he was actively working and he has a productive life. He was admitted to hospital with pneumonia, but he was not admitted with because of pneumonia, but because of a rapid deterioration of his clinical condition. The patient was admitted to hospital with fever, leukocytosis, high CRP, ascites, jaundice, very high bilirubin, grade 3 hepatic encephalopathy, and renal failure. The patient was directly admitted to the intensive care unit, and he died 4 days later with progressive impairment of liver, renal, and cerebral function. Well, this is a typical case of acute on chronic liver failure with the three main characteristics of the syndrome, which are decompensated cirrhosis, organ failure. This patient has 3 organ failures: liver failure, renal failure, and cerebral failure. And the third characteristic is a high risk of short-term mortality rate. Well, therefore, the aim of the study of the CLIF Consortium was to design diagnostic criteria for this syndrome. And the first thing we have to do is to define what kind of organ failure we should include in the diagnosis of the syndrome, and which will be the diagnostic criteria of each organ failure. And therefore, we used a modification of the SOFA score used by intensivists. And here you will see how the criteria for organ failure. Liver failure means bilirubin very high, greater than 12. Renal failure means serum creatinine greater than 2. Brain failure means hepatic encephalopathy grade 3 to 4. Coagulation means an INR equal or greater than 2.5. Circulatory failure, the need of vasopressors to maintain arterial pressure. And respiratory failure, according to the arterial oxygen pressure or the saturation, the pulse saturation. Therefore, this criteria was selected on mortality criteria, therefore, and also according to the number of patients included in both sides of the cutoff. Therefore, we had a diagnostic criteria for organ failure. The next thing we have to define was a high short mortality rate. And we decided to put the cutoff level of high short-term mortality rate on 28 days because it is approximately 50% of the mortality of septic shock, which is the most severe clinical condition in intensive care. The next point we have to solve is that there were many patients, a patient with one organ failure had a mortality rate lower than 15%, was 14.5%. Therefore, we have to refine whose patients with one organ failure should be considered as acute on chronic liver failure. Therefore, we need some additional prognostic parameters, and then we went to the SOFA score, and we compared patients with one organ failure, who died and who survived, and we found that cerebral dysfunction and renal dysfunction were very important prognostic markers in this particular group of patients. Here you will see the probability, the 28 mortality rate in the different group of patients. If you have no organ failure, that means the mortality rate is very low. It's 28 mortality day, 4.4%. If you have single non-renal organ failure with normal renal function, serum creatinine below 1.5, and no hepatic encephalopathy, the probability, the mortality rate, despite of having one organ failure, was also low, 6.3%. Therefore, this group of patients were considered to have no acute on chronic liver failure because they didn't accomplish the criteria of high short-term mortality rate. And this criteria is very important because these patients probably will need a very aggressive therapy, and to include patients with low mortality rate with aggressive therapy will not be a good thing. If the patient has single organ failure and the organ failure is the kidney, then the mortality rate is clearly higher than 15%, it's 18.6%. And if the patient has single organ failure associated with the two other criteria, that means renal dysfunction defined as an increased serum creatinine, or cerebral dysfunction as defined by hepatic encephalopathy grade 1 or 2, the mortality rate is also very high, 27%. Therefore, these two groups of patients with one organ failure were considered acute on chronic liver failure. One, if the patient has two organ failure, mortality rate is over 30%, and they are included in the group of acute on chronic liver failure 2. And finally, if the patient has three or more organ failure, the mortality rate is very high. Therefore, these are the methodology used to define acute on chronic liver failure and to stratify the patients into different grades. Well, here you may see the clinical characteristic of acute on chronic in the study, this study performed by the CLIF consortium. That this study called the Canonic study included is an observational study including 1,343 patients, therefore a large series of patients admitted to hospital for decompensated cirrhosis. And the prevalence of acute on chronic is very high. One every three patients being admitted to hospital with acute decompensation of cirrhosis have acute on chronic liver failure. Therefore, it is a very frequent syndrome. 22% show the syndrome at enrollment, at admission, and 10% develop the syndrome during hospitalization. Therefore, it's a very common syndrome. The frequency decrease, as expected, the frequency decrease according to the severity. The most frequent is acute on chronic liver failure 1. Acute on chronic liver failure 2 is relatively frequent, 35% of the acute uncrony liver failure. And acute uncrony liver failure 3 is the frequency is the lowest, is 14%. It occurs in young cirrhotics, 56 years old as a mean, significantly lower than in patients admitted to hospital with acute decompensation of cirrhosis without acute uncrony liver failure. The etiology of cirrhosis is mainly alcoholic, but in approximately 25%, it is associated to hepatitis C infection. This, the 0.5, is very interesting. This illustrates the time between the first decompensation and the development of the syndrome. And what it was extremely important was that in 26% of the patients being admitted with decompensated cirrhosis and acute uncrony liver failure, there were no prior history of acute decompensation. Therefore, the first manifestation of the disease was decompensation of cirrhosis associated to acute and chronic liver failure. Therefore, the concept that these patients have terminal liver disease is untruth. Many patients have this syndrome at the very beginning of cirrhosis. They don't have a long-standing cirrhosis. In another 15% of patients, the first decompensation occurred within 3 months, which means that approximately in 50% of the patients, you know, the beginning of the decompensation of cirrhosis and the development of acute uncrony liver failure is very short. Finally, the other important point are relates to the precipitating events. The most frequent precipitating event are bacterial infections and acute alcoholic liver injury, the second, and there are other that are the proportion is very low. However, what it is also very important is that in 45% of the patients, no precipitating event was identified, which means that the patient came to the hospital with severe liver disease and organ failure. And when you look for precipitating events in the medical history, there is no evident precipitating event. Well, here you will see the mortality rate at 28 days and at 90 days. You know, at 20 days, the mortality rate in patients without acute chronic liver failure is extremely low, is less than 2%, is 1.9%. Therefore, the patients who died from cirrhosis soon after admission are patients with acute chronic liver failure. And the mortality rate at 28 days increased to 22% in acute chronic liver failure 1, 32% in patients with acute uncrony liver failure 2, and 70% in patients with acute uncrony liver failure 3, but you know the mortality rate within this group varies depending on whether the patient have 3 organ failures, 4 organ failures, or 6 organ failures. Therefore, the diagnostic criteria, you know, is also a very important prognostic marker. Therefore, you can know the severity of the patients according to this. Well, another important point is that when you see a patient with acute uncrony liver failure, you cannot say anything about prognosis because it is a very dynamic condition. And here you will see what happened in the, you have the initial grade of acute uncrony liver failure, acute uncrony liver failure 1, 2, or 3, and the final grade, that may be no acute uncronic, acute uncrony liver failure 1, acute uncrony liver failure 2, or acute uncrony liver failure 3. And you may see the first important finding was that acute uncrony liver failure is a reversible condition. And you know, reversibility depends on the degree of acute uncronic at admission. If the patient have acute uncrony liver failure 1 at admission, you know the probability of having no acute uncrony during hospitalization is extremely high, 55%. If the patient have acute uncrony liver failure 2, that means 2 organ failure, for example, maybe renal failure and hepatic encephalopathy, the probability of reverse acute uncrony is also relatively high, 35%. And only patient with acute uncrony liver failure 3 have low probability reverse. But anyway, 16% of the patients recover from acute on chronic liver failure 3 with a standard medical therapy. That means if the patient is infected, you give antibiotics, etc. Therefore, this is the first condition, and the first important thing is a reversible condition. It may also deteriorate or remain steady, and you may see that patients with acute on chronic liver failure 3 usually remain with acute on chronic liver failure 3 with a standard medical therapy. If the patient has acute on chronic liver failure 2, it may progress in 25% of cases to acute on chronic liver failure 3, and you know in acute on chronic liver failure 1, the risk of progression to acute on chronic liver failure 2 and 3 is very low. Therefore, this means that, and you know, one important thing is that this evolution occurs usually within the first days after admission, in such a way that instead of giving a prognosis at admission, if you wait from 3 days to 5 days, you will be more accurate to emit prognosis. Therefore, the first thing we have to do is to put the patients on a standard medical therapy. If the patient has acute on chronic liver failure 1 or 2, and see what happens within 4 or 5 days. And if the patient has acute on chronic liver failure 3, we have to go directly to treat the syndrome. Well, here you may see what happens if you do this exercise. That means wait for a little before doing the prognosis. And here you may see the probability of survival of patients recovering from acute on chronic at the very beginning, lower than within a period ranging from 3 to 7 days. Patients who go to acute on chronic liver failure 1, patients who go to acute on chronic liver failure 2, and patients with going to acute on chronic liver failure 3. The first vertical line indicates what occurs at 28 days. And you may see the mortality rate in patients without acute on chronic is relatively high. But you know, you may know that many of these patients had acute on chronic liver failure 1, 2, or 3 just 3 to 7 days prior to this estimation. Therefore, patients who recover have a relatively good prognosis, and the prognosis get worse as the acute on chronic liver failure grade 3 to 7 days after admission is considered. Well, let's move to a little bit on pathogenesis. And you know, it's funny how regular laboratory tests can give as incredible information. For example, here you may see the leukocyte count and the C-reactive protein in no acute on chronic liver failure, acute on chronic liver failure 1, 2, and 3, and you may see that there is a progressive increase. Sorry, there is a progressive increase in these parameters as the severity of acute on chronic progresses, indicating that the syndrome is related to a systemic inflammation. And systemic inflammation is an important cause of organ failure. And therefore, this is a very interesting finding. And here you may see a more sophisticated study investigating pro- and anti-inflammatory cytokines in these patients. And you may see that in healthy subjects, cytokines, the levels are very low. In patients with cirrhosis, without acute on chronic liver failure, is very high, indicating that cirrhosis is an inflammatory condition. For patients with cirrhosis, without acute on chronic liver failure, has already a systemic inflammation. And you know, if the patient develops acute on chronic liver failure, then systemic inflammation is much more intense. Therefore, you know, acute on chronic liver failure really occurs in the setting of a marked systemic inflammation. And also you may see here that acute on chronic, the acute on chronic liver failure grades correlates with the level of cytokine production, in the sense that patients with acute on chronic liver failure 1 have less cytokines than acute on chronic liver failure 2, and this group have less cytokines than acute on chronic liver failure 3. Therefore, there is a very high level of cytokines. And you know, this resembles what occurs in sepsis. And this is also an acute syndrome, as in sepsis. Therefore, probably systemic inflammation plays a major role in the development of organ failure in acute and chronic liver failure. Well, which is the mechanism of systemic inflammation? Well, acute bacterial infection is a good cause, a good mechanism, particularly if the patient have already systemic inflammation as it occurs in the compensated cirrhosis. Acute liver injury, either acute alcoholic hepatitis or other forms of acute hepatic necrosis, produce a septic inflammation due to the release of dams that activates the immune system. And therefore, this may be the mechanism by which acute alcoholic hepatitis may be related also with multi-organ failure. But we have a 50% of the patients, approximately, who have no precipitating events. And this is the most interesting group of patients. And probably, acute on chronic liver failure in this group of patients is related to the translocation of bacterial products without viable bacteria from the intestinal lumen to the systemic circulation. Therefore, this is a potential mechanism that should be confirmed. Well, what about prognosis? Should we use the traditional scores, that is the MELD score, the MELD sodium score, or the Child-Pugh in these patients as it is we are doing now? Well, really not. You know, they are not good for predicting acute on chronic liver failure. Sorry. For example, here, you may see the probability of survival, the accuracy to predict survival in patients with acute on chronic liver failure using a new score that is calculated from the CLIF organ failure score that I showed you before to diagnose organ failure, age, and the degree of systemic inflammation estimated by the blood leukocytes. And the MELD score and the MELD sodium score. The red line is the new score, and it is much better than the MELD score and the MELD sodium score, probably because we include systemic inflammation in the calculation. Therefore, we should use the CLIF consortium acute on chronic liver failure score to estimate the risk of dying of patients with acute on chronic. There is also a more effective score that for patients with acute decompensation of cirrhosis by including again the white cell count. For example, this is we developed this score called CLIF consortium acute decompensation score, which includes age, sodium, creatinine, INR, and leukocytes. And you know, this is also significantly better predictive score than the MELD and the MELD sodium score. Therefore, systemic inflammation is very important also, not only for the pathogenesis of organ failure, but because of this, it is also important to be in the assessment of prognosis in patients with cirrhosis. Well, how can we use all these three scores I mentioned to you? Well, the first thing is what we have a patient admitted to hospital with acute decompensation. The first thing we have to assess is whether the patients have acute on chronic liver failure or not. And this can be done assessing the CLIF organ failure score. Then, if acute on chronic liver failure is present, we have to wait for a little bit, and in case of grade 3, we should include the patient in intensive care. But if the patient has no acute on chronic, we can be very accurate in predicting prognosis using the CLIF consortium acute decompensation score. If the score is low, the mortality rate is less than 2%, therefore it's excellent. If the score is high, we can get a 30% risk of mortality rate, indicating that this patient, we should manage this patient in a different way. What about patients with acute on chronic liver failure? Well, one of the major problems is whether this patient has to be treated or not treated in intensive care, because they may be too ill to be treated, to be admitted in an intensive care unit, particularly because the intensive care unit resources are very low in hospital. Therefore, we should identify whose patients have a very high mortality and probably will not benefit from intensive care. And this can be done using the classifications and the CLIF consortium acute on chronic liver failure score after 7 days, 3 7 days of admission. If the patient has 4 or 6 organ failures with the standard medical therapy, the probability of recover is extremely low, 90% mortality rate, 100%. Therefore, this patient probably will not benefit from intensive care, and we need new therapies to treat this patient. This can also be estimated by the CLIF consortium acute on chronic liver failure score. If it is higher than 64, the probability of dying 28 days after admission or 90 days is 100%. Therefore, we have criteria for treatment futility in this patient. Well, what about liver transplantation? Because these are acute patients. Therefore, why we treat acute liver failure by putting the patient into an emergency waiting list, and these patients are in a regular waiting list? Well, we don't know why. Because, look, these are the probability of surviving of patients from this study I mentioned you, the canonic study, patients who were transplanted within 28 days after acute on chronic liver failure 2 or 3, 3 7 days after admissions, and the mortality rate in patients not transplanted. If you transplant these patients, the 1 year probability of survival is 80%. Therefore, this call the attention that probably we should consider this patient not as a regular cirrhotic. Well, this is the conclusions I have sent to you. Acute on chronic liver failure is a distinct syndrome in cirrhosis characterized by acute decompensation, organ failure, and high short-term mortality rate. It may occur at any time during the course of the disease, from compensated to decompensated cirrhosis. In 25% of the patient was compensated and then developed suddenly acute decompensation and acute on chronic liver failure. It is related to acute systemic inflammatory reaction due to bacterial infections, acute liver injury, or unidentified mechanism, and it may be possible that it's translocation of bacterial products. Prognosis of acute on chronic liver failure depends on the severity of systemic inflammation and number of organ failures, not on the precipitating event. Finally, CLIF consortium acute decompensation score and CLIF consortium acute on chronic liver failure score are useful tools for the management and prognostication in patients with decompensated cirrhosis. Well, thank you very much for your invitation and your attention.
We have time for one or two questions, so let me start. Vicente, the prevalence was 32% of the acute on chronic liver failure. Is that 32% of all patients admitted to the consortium with cirrhosis for any reason?
Well, we did the study in we were able, because there are there were 29 hospitals participating in the study. We included consecutive patients, and we were able to finish the study within 4 months. This indicates the power of the consortium. Therefore, they were consecutive patients with admitted to hospital with the compensated cirrhosis for treatment. And of course, they had no hepatocellular carcinoma outside the Millian criteria, or no heart failure, or respiratory failure, or other serious pathology.
Okay. Yes.
Professor Arroyo, thanks for this splendid overview of the problem. If one takes at face value the numbers which you have shown of cytokines going up during the acute presentation of acute and chronic liver failure, one would think that at least in those cases who are not dependent from bacterial infection, let's call them primary acute and chronic liver failure, short-term suppression of this sort of inflammatory response by, say, anti-TNF-alpha or similar molecules might even be beneficial. But if one looks at what has been done in acute alcoholic hepatitis on cirrhosis, which I suspect in most cases were acute on chronic liver failure cases, anti-TNF-alpha at least has not shown to be beneficial. What are the perspectives of manipulating this acute inflammatory response in terms of improving survival in these patients?
Well, you know, this is the $1 million question, $1 million question. You know, the problem is that there are so many mechanisms leading to systemic inflammation that, you know, TNF-alpha is only a part. Therefore, I don't think blocking the periphery, you will solve this syndrome. I think you have to go upper in the mechanism. Well, it was the same as acute as type 1 hepatorenal syndrome, that is another type of acute and chronic. That if you give prostaglandins, renal vasodilators, you do not improve the syndrome. You improve the syndrome when you improve circulatory function, that is the origin. Therefore, what we have to go is to try to block bacterial translocation. I think this is essential. And you know, the problem we have now measured to block bacterial translocation. But you know, we improve something, bacterial translocation, but we lead to bacterial infection caused by resistant bacteria. Therefore, it will be very complex to solve this problem. But anyway, we now know that we should not speak about this patient have hepatic encephalopathy, renal failure, and liver failure because he's jaundiced. No. This is inappropriate. The patient have acute on chronic liver failure and has a problem over this that are systemic inflammation.
Vicente, can I ask you a question? One of the concerns in the United States with the MELD allocation system is patients with acute and chronic liver failure jump to the head of the queue and get transplanted quickly, whereas patients who've had a more stepwise progression are disadvantaged, and the outcome for the liver transplant of the acute and chronic liver failure group is generally inferior to patients with a more gradual progression in their MELD score. So I was interested in your results. It looks like you an 80% one-year survival after liver transplant?
Yes, 80%. Yeah. And you know, we also review the causes of death in the whole group of patients, which were the causes of death. And you know, the main cause of death was acute and chronic. The second cause of death was septic shock. And the second cause of death was hepatocellular carcinoma, and the third cause of death was septic shock. Therefore, very few patients died as a consequence of a slow, progressive liver failure. This is common in kidney disease, but in liver disease, in cirrhosis, most of severe liver failure is acute and chronic liver failure.
All right, I think we'll have to move on. Thank you very much, Professor Royer.